given your faces here today. You're all welcome, welcome. Can someone remind us what we've been talking about? Finding rest for your soul. Praise the Lord. Finding rest for your soul. We started by looking at Ecclesiastes, and we saw in Ecclesiastes that the Bible says, vanity of vanities, or meaningless. Everything is what? Everything is meaningless. When you consider everything from the viewpoint of life, of human beings, when you take God out of the equation and you try to make sense of life, we know that Solomon, the Bible says, was the wisest man who ever lived. Praise the Lord. And he said he tried everything. He said he tried pleasure, he tried music, he says he tries laughter. He said it was foolishness. He indulged himself a little bit. He said he tried pleasure. He said he tried work. He tried gardening. He said it was what? It was meaningless. Praise the Lord. And last week, that was week before last week, we looked at that Ecclesiastes 1 and 2. That was week before last. And last week, we looked at the things we can do to find rest for our soul. Praise the Lord. Things we can do to find rest for our soul. And we talked about doing what is right at all times. To mention two scriptures that we must never forget. Can anyone remind me? Praise the Lord. Yes, sir.
If you do what is right, you will not be accepted.
If you do what is right, you will not be accepted. That's one of the key scriptures of last week. It says, if you do what is right, you can be guaranteed that God will accept you. Praise the Lord. What was the other scripture? He said, we must never forget. You've forgotten already. Okay. Anyone? If we do what is right, you will be accepted. Or as the scripture says, if you do what is right, will you not be accepted? So what was the other scripture? We mentioned another scripture that we must never forget. That he who does what is right is righteous. Thank you, man. He who does what is right is righteous. Praise the Lord. And I did mention that the other thing we can do to find the rest for our soul is to find the purpose for our life. Amen. Is to find purpose for our life. And I thought I was going to give you just that one point for you to go and find purpose for your life. But Pastor caught me and said, you have to conclude. And through the night, I was a bit restless as I was telling my wife this morning. I said, who has ever really come up and said, I have really found the meaning of life? So why was it me standing here today and telling people that I found the meaning or the purpose of life so that we can find rest for our souls? Praise the Lord. For God is faithful. The book of God, the Bible, is the manual for life. And we cannot find purpose for life outside of the manual for life. Amen? We cannot find purpose of life. The purpose, why we are trying to look for the purpose of life, is so that we may find rest for our souls. Praise the Lord. The purpose of life, before we look at how to find the purpose of life, let's look very quickly at how not to find the purpose, or where you will not find the purpose of life. I know we talked about this very good extensively. But let's look again, where you will not find the purpose of life. It says you will not find the purpose of life by accumulating wealth. If you're trying to find purpose in life so that you find rest for your soul, something that you will do under the sun, it's not in accumulating wealth. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Luke chapter 12 and 15. Luke 12, 15 says, and he said unto them, take heed and beware of covetousness. For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesses. Praise the Lord. The worth of a man, or the purpose of a man, the fulfillment of a man does not consist in the accumulation of wealth. We've said before that you will not find wealth in the indulgence of the flesh or indulging in pleasure. Pleasure offers a lot. It offers to give you this and to give you that. But the more you try, you will not find purpose in life or rest in it. Sir, the purpose of life is not to be found in work. Work, work, work till you drop. Solomon says, indulge yourself in work, in hard work. He took pleasure from all the things he did, but he did not find pleasure, or he did not find fulfillment or purpose in it. The first thing we need to understand in order to find purpose in life can be found in Ecclesiastes. We're going to be looking at a few more scriptures as we round up this mini-series. And there's no better place to go than where we started, Ecclesiastes chapter 3 again, and 1 to 2. Can we have it in NIV, please, or NLT? Sorry, thank you. NLT. It says, for everything there is a season and a time for every activity under heaven. Let us pause there a little bit. For everything there is a time and a season for every activity under heaven. Let's just hear this one in the wise. Verse 2. It says, a time to be born and a time to die. Let's stop there. In order to find the purpose of life, so that you will find rest for your soul, I think the most crucial thing to understand is there's a time to be born and there's a time to die. There's a beginning and there's an end. But sometimes we do get carried away in life's business. In our strive to achieve, you know, our efforts to climb the ladder, career ladder, property ladder, wealth ladder. There are all kinds of ladders. Amen? And we get carried away and we acquire and accumulate. And like the Bible said, the work of a man does not consist of his material possession. It is not what he has or how much he has piled together. That's not the work of a man. Why? Because there is a time to be born. The only person that will not in this room, the person in this room that is present here that will not die, is a good death. Is the person that can say they were not born into this world. For every one of us who were born into this world, it is guaranteed. The Bible says it. There was a time. I know many of us, every week, every month, Sister Lisa, mommy, you send your text messages. Say it's your birthday. And there is a time to be born, there is a time to die. In between, we have to find our purpose. Amen? In between, we have to find our purpose. Verse 9, Ecclesiastes 3, verse 9. 9 says, what do people really get for all their hard work? Verse 10. I have seen the burden God has placed on us all. Yet God has made everything beautiful in its own time. The Bible says, what has been made cannot be added to. Amen? What God has created, the Bible says in Genesis that God made the heavens and the earth and he rested. And the work of God is complete. We run from the moment we were born till the moment we die. We run for purpose, we run for rest, we run and we race and we do everything. But Bible says God rested. And the one who created everything, Bible says he has made it beautiful. It means God has perfected everything. The time that God made them, is made them beautiful. There's nothing we can add to it, no matter how we run and how much we run. And we know that our time is limited. But there's a time to be born and there's a time to die. It says, but he has planted eternity in the human heart. He has planted eternity in the human heart. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from the beginning till the end. I like a translation that I'm going to try and bring up here. NET Bible. He said, God has made everything fit beautifully in its appropriate time. But he has also placed ignorance in the hearts of men so that people cannot discover what God has ordained from the beginning to the end of their lives. Everybody think I will not die. In the people know it. They know that the most guaranteed thing in life is death. Everybody knows it. But individually, for some reason, everybody thinks it's not me, I will not die. Or I cannot imagine myself dying. Why? Bible says God has placed eternity in our hearts. We want to live forever, so we want to accumulate and accumulate and accumulate. And like the scripture says, the work of a man is not in the abundance of what he has. It says, because we came what? How did we come? It says we come empty, come naked and empty-handed. If they bury anybody with anything, I can guarantee you that thing remains in the soil. No matter the worth of that gold, the gold ring, gold wristwatch, or whatever they do these days, we come empty-handed, and we will go empty-handed. And God has made everything beautiful in its own time. And God has rested. So how can we find the rest for our soul? The only way we can find the rest for our soul is when we find purpose in God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When we find out the purpose for which God has placed us in this world, then we can rest with God. Because if God has created everything and he has put an end to it, and what has been completed cannot be added to, the only thing we can do is to rest with God in his purpose for our lives. So how can we find purpose? 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. It says, see what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called the children of God. Psalms 139 verse 13. Psalms 139 from 13. It says, for you created my inmost being. Said, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Verse 14. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. Verse 15. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion. I was woven together in the dark of the womb. Next one. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day has passed. Every day of my life was recorded where?
In your book.
In his book. And there's a time to be born and there's a time to die. And the Bible says, behold what manner of love that the Father has shown to us, has called us his children. I think the first thing we need to realize to find purpose and rest in life is to realize that we are products of God's love. Amen?
Amen.
We are products of God's love and to be content in that. Everything that God has made, he has made, he has completed, there's nothing we can add to it. Cosmetic surgery will promise you that they can add a bit of this and add a bit of that. They can add cheeks or take away cheeks. But it doesn't add anything to what God has made. Amen. We are products of God's love and we should try and find our rest in it. We won't stop there. We should also respond to God's love in order to find rest for our soul. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. The first thing I want us to know this morning is that we are products of God's love and we should find rest in that. Deuteronomy 6 and 5. It says, love the Lord your God. Thank you very much. Thanks. With all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your heart. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Not only are we products of God's love, we must respond to God's love by loving God with all of our being. Instead of focusing our energy, like Pastor was explaining, you wake up at 5 o'clock, you are on the train at 6 o'clock, you come back at 6:30, you are tired, you are knackered, and I didn't hear the news, but maybe that's what's going to happen. And then you buy the house, and then they take the house, and you pay the mortgage, and by the time you finish paying, you are dying, then you die, and if you don't take the house, the children pay 40% tax from it. And it's just a waste if we don't sit down to think and consider that how can we find purpose and how can we find rest. We are product of God's love. There's nothing we can add to ourselves. If we stay within the context of the purpose for which God has created us, we will find rest. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
How can we respond to God's love? By loving Him with all of our hearts. And even that, because of the fallen nature of man, to love the Lord with all your heart and with all your soul and with God. Is it really possible? It's only possible through the Spirit of God. Amen?
Amen.
It's only possible through, and that is a gift of God. So I say this morning that if there is anyone who has not really accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, that is why Jesus Christ said, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." You will find rest in God's love, but you cannot really love God unless you have the Spirit of God, because it is impossible. The Bible says, "I try to do what is good." Every time I try to think what is right, I put in a lot of effort, but I fail woefully. Then He said, "There is no condemnation because God has put His Spirit within me." Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
The other way we can find our purpose in life, let's open our Bibles. Isaiah. Praise the Lord. I can't find the scripture here, but it says in Isaiah, that God has created us for His glory. The purpose for which God has created us is to give glory. Amen?
Amen.
Is to give glory unto Him, because the Bible says in Genesis that God made man in His own image, and after His own likeness, He created us. What does it mean to give glory to God? What does it mean when we say we give glory to God? It means to honor God with our lives. To find rest for our soul, we have to learn.
Isaiah 43:7.
Thank you, sir. It says, "But all who claim me as their God, for I have made them for my glory. It was I who created them." If our life does not give glory to God, we will not find rest in life. The whole purpose of man has been created to give glory to God. The Bible says God created man in His own image. Before then, God never made anything in His own image. But when He came to man, He made man in His own image. And the Bible says He placed man in the Garden of Eden. And He blessed man. He blessed them. So anyone that is not living a life that honors God, to give glory to God, means to honor God. If you're not living a life that honors God, we will not find rest for our soul. If we live for ourselves, the Bible says we will die. But if we live for God, we will find purpose and we will find fulfillment for life. 1 Chronicles 16:28. How do we give glory to God? 1 Chronicles 16:28. It says, "Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations, ascribe to the Lord, glory and strength. Basically, he's saying, give unto the Lord glory that is due his holy name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. The same thing in Psalms, in the Psalms. It says, give unto the Lord what belongs to God. God has made us for him. He has not made us for ourselves. So when we try to live outside of the purpose for which God has made us, it will be impossible. Jesus Christ said, Lord, I have glorified you. Why? He said, I have glorified you. He said, now glorify me with the glory. Amen. Praise the Lord. Psalms 8, 3 to 9. Why should we glorify God? Psalms 8, 3 to 9. It says, when I look at the night sky and and see the works of your fingers, that is alone to glorify God. If you glorify any other thing, you glorify the latest model of Lexus, of BMW, of anything, you will not find purpose or rest for your life. But if you lift up your eyes, like Solomon said, he said, under heaven, everything is meaningless. But if you lift up your eyes beyond the viewpoint of under the sun, he said, when you look at the night sky and see the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you set in place, verse 4, it says, what are people that you should think about them? Man is dust, the Bible says. He said, the beauty of a man is like what? He said, it's like the flower of the field that fades away. It's like dew, morning dew. He said, it's only for a while. He says, what are people that you should think about them? Mere mortals that you should care for them. What makes us special is because God cares for us.
Hallelujah.
And if you don't rest in that fact, that you are a product of God's love, that God cares for you, you will never find rest for your soul. It says, yet you make them a little lower than God and crown them with glory and honor. He crowned us with glory. That is why we need to glorify him. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Many times we even take it for granted that we are human beings. How many of us would like to be a lovely antelope? Beautiful, springing antelope, at the mercy of a wild lion. You think it's cute to be an antelope, you don't have to get the mortgage. It's not cute. How many of us would have preferred to be a goat? You know, we don't even consider these things, that it is a privilege being a human being. Someone that was created in the image of the glorious God. This morning we're singing, holy, holy, holy. God created us for himself. God created us to share his love with us. God created us for us to rest and to share the rest that he experienced after the creation of the world. Verse 6. He said, you gave charge, you gave them charge of everything. I always say to my daughter, when we talk about animals and humans, and we talk about them, they're a little bit scared of foxes, you know. And sometimes they'll like try to bolt the door in the back and try to lock it in everywhere. And then they'll start to imagine, oh, what if the fox comes up, what if they take the lead, and they come and they try to open the door. I said to them, foxes are not that clever. Foxes are not clever because they've not been created in the image of God. Even though people may say, there is no God, we are a product of accident, there was a big bang, and that, and that. No other living thing has done the things that man has done. Even when we look at the things that we have done, that we can take a mobile phone, I can speak into it, and I can speak to someone in the US. And when we look at the fact that we can get a plane in the air, and it will sustain itself, and it can fly for 24 hours non-stop, that is because we have been created like the Creator. That is because we are creators ourselves. It says he gave us charge of everything and put all things, even the wild animals, we can tame them. They can't tame us. They can't control us, but we can tame them. God has given us His glory. And in this fact, if we rest in this fact, in the little things that God, they're not little things, but in the little things that the Bible mentions that are big things of our lives, we will find rest. How can we find rest for our soul? Or how can we find purpose so we may find rest? Genesis chapter 2 and verse 15. Genesis chapter 2 and verse 15. It says, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. I want us to back up a little bit. Now, verse 8. And then we can go to the end. It says, now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east in Eden, and there he put the man he had made. Notice, it wasn't the man that planted the garden. It wasn't the man that planted the garden. The Lord God took the man, verse 15, and put him in the Garden of Eden to do what? To work it and to take care of it. The work of God has been completed. What is our work? Our work is just to care for it. The Bible says, God, that we are not to work and strive and slave all day long, 9 to 5, just because we want to find purpose. God has made everything for us. Our purpose is to take care of where God has placed us. And where has God placed you? Praise the Lord. Anywhere you find yourself, that is where God has placed you. Anywhere you find yourself, that is where God has placed you. In this church, that is where God has placed you. Imagine this church with the Garden of Eden. And God has placed you in this garden. What is God saying to you? God is saying, take care of this thing. Praise the Lord. The Bible says, after God created the man, He created the woman for what? For companionship. So the purpose of our life, we can see, are threefold. One, to glorify God. Praise the Lord. One, to glorify God. Two, to take care of the things God has entrusted to us, like God entrusted the Garden of Eden to Adam. And number three, for companionship. So how can you find rest for your soul? Ecclesiastes 3, 12 to 13. I know that there is nothing better than a man to be happy and to do good while they live. That each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. Everywhere God has placed us, we are custodians of the work of God. And God will inquire of us how we have kept what He has entrusted to us. One of the reasons we don't find rest is because we don't want to settle where God has placed us. God said to Adam, He said, of all the trees you may eat, but this one don't do. God says to a man, you are free to do whatever you like with your wife, and to the woman, you are free with your husband. But even within that context, the man's heart is not settled. Everywhere God has placed us, that is where the glory of God is. And God will require from each one of us that what have you done? How have you taken care of the companion that I've given to you? God will require of you what you have done to take care of me. Being in this same assembly, the Bible says when we get to heaven, God will not ask us how much money were you able to save on that? You know, how many houses were you able to buy on that? How many times were you able to get promotion? How high did you elevate yourself? But God will ask you that. The brother and the sister and the wife and the friends and the people are placed in your life. When they were naked, what did you do? When they were hungry, what did you do? When they were homeless, what did you do? When they were destitute, what did you do? In order to find purpose in life, we have to sometimes look outside of ourselves. If you look inward, we won't find purpose in life. But if we look outward of ourselves, and we look at the things God has done for us, and we look at the things God has given us, wives, family, and we use those things to glorify God. And as we use those things to glorify God, God will be glorified.
Yeah.
And it will give us rest, because God has created everything already. Praise the Lord. But if we decide that the grass is greener on the other side, like Eve, remember last week we said, if you do what is right, your countenance will be lifted. Remember Adam and Eve, people didn't do what was right. Because they looked to the things that God said they should not look to. And as human, we have this habit, we have this mentality of thinking, the grass is greener outside. The grass is greener outside. If only I can leave this two bedroom flat and move to a three bedroom flat. If only I can leave this three bedroom flat and go and buy a townhouse. If only I can move from health sector and move into the financial sector. If only I can move from this job into everything. But where God has put us, what are we doing there? That's the question we need to ask ourselves this morning. Are we finding purpose in the garden that God has placed us in? Or are we looking like Eve and we are saying, it is that tree of knowledge that I'm going to find purpose in? Let's bow our heads this morning.
Hallelujah.
I want us to talk to God this morning. That God will help us to find rest in the things that He has put in our lives. Now, many times we are looking outward when we are supposed to be looking inwardly. Now, we can't wait just to get rid of our friends so that we can make new friends. Because we think the friends that we are going to make are better friends, not the ones we have, they are always annoying us. Now, sometimes we can't wait to leave the companionship of the people God has placed in our lives because we think the grass is greener on the other side. We rush through life, you know, without really enjoying life. We race, we pace, as we try for the next new thing. The next new thing, there's always a new thing to try. There's always a new career to aspire to. This is what's winning, this is what's qualifying people to get new jobs, to get the market. But we fail to appreciate the work of God in our lives. No, we fail to give honor to God and glory. The Bible says, ascribe to Him the glory that is due His name. Because God has honored and glorified us. No, we fail to look after the place He has placed us. The Bible says, God placed, Adam did not create the garden, but God placed him as a custodian in the garden. The wife God has given you, are you looking after her? The husband God has given you, are you looking after, or you're looking outside, wishing your husband was like this man or your wife was like that woman? The church God has placed you in for companionship, for friendship, to look after, the Bible says, how are you doing the job? Are you being fed while the people beside you are going hungry? Do you think you are finding purpose in your life by accumulating wealth unto yourself? But you're not looking unto the destitute. You have no regard for the fatherless. You have no regard for those who cannot pay their rent. You think life is all about you. The Bible says there's a time to be born and there's a time to die. Everlasting Father, we thank you for this morning. I say, Lord, Father, in this our short life that we have to live here on earth, Father, I pray that you will give us the wisdom, Father, not to lay our treasures on earth, O Lord. Father, because the Bible says if we lay our treasures on earth, corruption will set in. But give us the wisdom and the grace to lay our treasures in heaven, so that our hearts may be set on heaven. And we know that if our hearts are set on you, we will find rest. Father, we ask this morning, O Lord, that you will give us the grace not to live unto ourselves. Father, from the provision you have given us, Father, give us a willing heart to share with those who lack. Father, give us a wise heart, O Lord God, to house those who are homeless. us and give us a wise spirit, O Lord, to enjoy our life with the wife of our youth, to enjoy our life with our partners, O Lord. Give us a wise spirit, O Lord, to stop looking outside where the grass is greener. Father, as we go today, Lord, we pray that we should find rest in you, Lord. Father, there's no rest in any other thing apart from you. Father, as we glorify your name, through the things that we do the things, through the things that we say, as we glorify your name, Father, by singing praises to you, as we glorify your name, Father, by emulating your characters, Father, we pray that truly, O Lord, you will show us the individual purposes that are written in your books for our lives, O Lord, and you will cause us to find rest for the rest of our lives in Jesus' name. Amen.